Tonight, I'm going to show you how to start your own wine cellar.
Please,
special announcements. Not Spike Milligan. Spike
Milligan,
would you please look at the
arrivals board?
Would Mr. Milligan please
look
up at the arrivals board?
Hello, Spike.
Hello.
Fancy seeing you.
Yeah.
Have you looked up there? It says...
Arrivals.
Yes.
That's what I am. I'm an arrival.
Yes.
Well, the cameras aren't just here for the reunion, but because tonight, ex-bombardier Spike Milligan, this is your life.
You call this a life?
But you're going to do it, aren't you?
I've got to do it now. I need the money.
Dick Scratcher, founder of Amnesics Anonymous, this is your life.
I wonder what it was.
Long before the goons were invented, your story began April 16, 1918, Spike, when you were born at a place I can't pronounce.
Amanaga.
Thank you. India. Terence Allen Milligan, son of Warrant Officer Leo Milligan, serving in the regular army there. As a matter of fact, Spike, you come from a long line of military men.
Shabash Shivaji. Virkudi.
India. As a boy, I watched India through fresh, empirical eyes. Inside my young khaki head, I grew not knowing any other world. My mother had a very difficult delivery. They'd put a towel on the bedhead rail. When you felt the contraction coming on, you just did this to try and get rid of the tension. And she was in a rage. She said, "Get away from me! I don't want to see another man as long as I live." She used to dote on me. I was covered in dote marks. That's all I knew from the day I opened my eyes. I was an Indian. She was very highly strung. She just clattered me. Wallop on the head, yeah. And I reminded her of that. Yes, before she died, I said, "You used to beat me a lot when I was a child." She said, "No, I didn't." I said, "Yes, you bloody well did. I know, I was there." And I think that, in fact, my father was very rarely at home, had its effect upon me. That was the reason for wetting bed, I think, yeah. My father was a great khaki warrior. My mother was beautiful and never washed dishes. Other people did that. I was only four. I remember they cleaned my shoes, made my bed. Idarao, come karo. Yet in time, I found them gentler than the khaki people. They smiled in their poverty. Do you know, I seem to be happy. The photographs of me look happy. I just found a couple of two old ones I recently found, and I'm doing something like this, or doing something abnormal. Yes. In March 1929, my father wrote to me just before my 11th birthday. "My darling Terence, your sweet letter safely to hand, and I'm always pleased to receive a letter from you and to hear how you and your dear little brother, Desmond, are getting on. He is a big boy now and will be able to take part in the cowboy games with us when I eventually get leave."
People lived with guns in those days. Not only Dad. Dad may have been exceptionally, he loved playing cowboys and having lots of guns, but everybody had weapons. It was a normal thing.
This is a very interesting room.
It's the gun room, which belonged to my father. He was a collector of antique firearms and also a ballistic expert. There's a span here of about 250 years. The oldest one is this one here. That is the oldest one in the collection. It's about 1780. He went to America when he was quite young and rode as a cowboy in an area called Brownsville. And he was a cowboy. And these are his spurs from those days, yes. These are his war medals. As you can see, he did quite a bit of service.
Dad's contract had expired for his service in the army. Now, normally he would have just either signed on again or just gone on a temporary basis, but they said, no, your time's expired, you are now put on the retirement lists. So, virtually, he got the boot.
Part of the universe are we in?
Captain, it looks like Catford.
Catford?
It was all boring to me, all sunless. No sunshine, nothing at all. No open spaces. Everything was like brick walls here everywhere, you know. But I think it's a period in my life that I can't recollect with very good reason. Desmond, it was a culture shock for him because he had never known anything else except sunshine. And he went very quiet.
Mum was into her 30s and suddenly found she had to do her own cooking, she had to do her own washing, her own ironing and clean the house. And so that was an even bigger shock. But she was an extremely stoic woman.
Catford, 1933. My mother lives in a steaming sink. Boiled haddock condenses on my plate. Its body cries for the sea. My father places his unemployment cards in his wallet. There's plenty of room for them there. They sent me to Brownhill Road School. The first time I've seen chaps wanking, they had to go in the toilets and wank. My father caught me doing it once. And he didn't know what to say. He said, stop that. Do you want all your children to be thin? In greaseproof paper, my mother wraps my banana sandwiches. It's 5:40, 10 minutes to catch the last workman's tram. Who was the last workman? Was it me? I might be famous. My father and I walk out and are eaten by a yellow freezing fog. Somewhere, the Prince of Wales and Mrs. Simpson are having morning tea in bed. God save the King, but God help the rest of us.
I got that photograph of you, it's in my head, and it won't ever fade away.
Wow, yeah. Platform One, London Bridge. A greyer, more desolate scene for romance would be hard to find. And yet, Lily Dunford saw me with a group of friends and decided that she'd go for it. And she did. And she was so pretty and beautiful and shapely. And I did this to her. She said, why are you doing that? I said, well, I surrender.
Did the world ever pay the world?
Exquisite legs and nice boobs, which I gave the occasional squeeze in the early days, and then confessed it to the priest the next day. Father, I squeezed a woman's boobs. Or did you know? How many times did you do that, my son? Go and say three Hail Marys before our fathers. I used to think it was a sin. I really did. Yes. The trumpet I was playing was not very good. And I thought I could do with a better trumpet. So I started to rob cigarettes and tobacco. And I robbed enough to buy a Besson trumpet, which was great. In the meantime, they caught me. And I said, yes, sirs, I don't know how I can say this to them. I was buying a trumpet. That didn't make much sense to them. They wanted to know where the cigarettes were going, you know. That's it. And my father came and they took me to a court. And my father put his deep acting voice on. This boy was not made to work in a cigarette factory. This boy was meant to be a very fine musician. All he was trying to do was find his place in life. What would a few cigarettes compared with a wonderful musician? Would you have stopped Chopin if he had been stealing cigarettes? Of course you wouldn't. that's the end of a case. And because I was quite a loud player, I had to put a sock in the end of it and play in an airing cupboard, which is at 108 degrees in heat. I lost a stone learning the trumpet.
I know he'd come back very late at night, you see, like most of the Dylan boys, you see, and Mum would be standing on the stairways. What are you doing coming home at this time of night? What do you think the neighbours will think of you? You know, all this business, you see, and I'd be in my bedroom listening to all this thing. Poor blighter, you know, he's getting a hell of a roasting.
You'll ruin your health. You'll ruin your health playing the trumpet. Bit by bit, I learned to play it very, very well, and I was very good, and I was playing in all the Southeast London bands.
He was a bloody good trumpeter. He knew sound. He had a feeling for sound, for rhythm, for how long things could go on before they should stop, for how long beats and noises should go on and still be a kind of music or have a dramatic rhythm to them.
Across the channel, Adolf Hitler is blissfully unaware of the part you will play in his downfall. Your offensive begins quietly on June the 2nd, 1940, when you become 954024 Gunner Milligan Terrence.
God, he's got my number. It was a proud day for me as two military policemen dragged me screaming from the house. And got this travel warrant, you know. And when I got there, they took me up with my suitcase, and I was in civilians, and this major didn't know because the army, all the other boys were in uniform. He said, why are you... He says, Gunner Milligan, sir. He said, why are you wearing mufti? I said, well, they wouldn't let me on the train naked, sir. And the sergeant said, silence when you speak to an officer. Oh, dear.
The young warrior plays trumpet in the D Battery dance band and spends two happy years touring around Bexhill-on-Sea.
Yeah, but of course, we were young. We were like the Beatles of Bexhill, you know.
The boys in the battery used to think I was pretty wild. Yes, I don't remember being particularly funny.
I was in the billet and the King came over to me. He said, Dad, there's a bloke over there who plays a smashing trumpet. He's laying on his bed. So I said, oh, that sounds all right. And I used to thump the piano, as you know, in that way. Yeah. And so we galloped over there, didn't we, to listen to this guy.
Yeah, yeah. A terrific left hand, I remember.
It turned out to be Spike. We didn't know he was Spike then. But then, of course, once we found out he was a musician, then the major wanted to know, what about forming a band?
Yeah.
And of course, Spike stood out in front and blasted the trumpet. What were the tunes? He was very good.
You remember the tunes?
Honeysuckle Rose, Lady Be Good.
China Boy, Limehouse Blues, you know, Basin Street Blues, and all the latest ballads, you know, You Stepped Out of a Dream.
The thing was, Spike behind me, he always tried to throw me on this one.
Oh, yeah.
And he used to be very quietly, they always couldn't hear. He said, deep in my heart there is rupture, but for that I would have upped you. And so on and so on. But I withstood it, I can tell you that.
We were enjoying the war very, very much, I'm sorry to say. We didn't want it to stop. I thought of writing to Hitler and saying, look, keep this going just for a while. Just don't bomb my mother.
January the 6th, the 1943, the midnight, weather, the pissing down. Standing in the black street, the hammer of the Germans, D Battery, stands silent in full FSMO, with arms aching from typhus, typhoid and tetanus injections. Edgerton and I have been detailed to carry a porridge container. Creak! Back!
I think they're probably a truer picture of what life was like in the services during those years than any of the important four-part history documents that have been published.
Well, there was a wanker, and his bed was touching mine, and he'd start this wanker, and my bed was shaking like this, and he went on for an hour. I thought, Christ, for Christ's sake, get it over with, you know. So I went to the sports store next day and put this right-handed boxing glove in his bed. Oh dear, oh dear. God is doing it. I can't see it as an obscenity. I think it's just a reality of life that people do it, you know.
It was going to be a long war. There's one drawback, no ammunition. But this didn't deter Leather Suitcase. He soon had all the gun crew shouting bang in unison. Fire!
Bang!
Helps keep up morale, he told visiting General Allenbrook, who had to be restrained from joining the Germans.
I started to get frightened from Italy, because it was a pretty hairy war, that one. That really was like a bit like World War II, you know. I got wounded at the Colli di Miano. We were trying to carry up batteries for the OP, and the fucking Germans must have seen us. They started to mortar us, and I got down. The one must have burst somewhere near my head, and I got blown up. I think I was blown up. Come to think of it, I should have stayed out there. And they put us in an ambulance, and as we returned to the gun lines, the moment a gun went off, I jumped like this. I was finished as a soldier. They used to call it shell shock in World War I. It was called battle fatigue in this. I'd run out of guts, that's what it was.
I still think he would have been all right if he'd have been sympathetically treated by the battery commander. Instead of him going in and calling him a coward and everything else, he should have said to
him...
Is that what he did? He went in there more or less and told Spike he was a coward. And if he'd have said to Spike, you know, things will be all right, you just have a nice rest and things things like that.
But this was Jumbo, wasn't it?
And Spike went down from there because no way did he want to leave the battery. Yeah. He'd have been looked after by us if he'd have stayed to come back to us.
Right, yeah.
And we'd have nursed him back.
Yeah. We were not professional soldiers, but
we were all in the same boat.
He shouldn't have been there. I mean, lots of us got blown up, but we didn't come out of it manic depressive. We came out of it very happy because we were still surviving.
The Milligan had suffered from his legs terribly during the war in Italy. While his mind was full of great heroisms under shellfire, his legs were carrying on the idea of speed in the opposite direction. The battery major had not understood. Gunner Milligan, you've been acting like a coward. No, sir, not true. I'm a hero with coward's legs. I'm a hero from the waist up. Silence! Why did you leave your post? We had woodworm in it, sir. The roof of the trench was falling in. Silence! You acted like a coward. I wasn't acting, sir. I could have you shot! Shot? Why didn't they shoot me in peacetime? I was still the same coward.
You don't like that? He's like electric. Like you wind up a doll. Hello! And he fascinated me for a month. I gradually got used to what he was saying, you know. He wasn't saying anything. Just, and we used to tour, and I was in the band playing the trumpet. I could do both things, play trumpet and roll the guitar. And we used to, with the band, he used to come in, it's the officers' club in Naples.
I saw nothing in him, you know. He was a mess. Just a mess.
Sweethearts. That was it, you know. He left the stage smothered in soap.
I remember being in this huge barrack room. We were all arrived and all been given blankets and things to settle ourselves down. And in one corner was Bill Hall, a tall fellow who'd been with me in the concert party at Eberly. A little fellow called Johnny Mulgrew, who'd come from somewhere else, and Spike. And Bill Hall unpacked his instrument and started to play. And Bill Hall and Johnny Mulgrew had this double bass because he'd been in an orchestra. He started playing along with it. And Milligan got the trumpet, and he had a guitar as well. And it was magic that day, at that moment, these three started playing, and they formed an act called the Bill Hall Trio.
I wanted to get on in life, so I got in touch with Mulgrew and Bill Hall, and we got an agent, and we were getting £75 a week for the act. We thought we were millionaires.
And I remember him giving me a couple of tickets to come and see him at, I don't remember the theatre in London, one of the old theatres, and watching him and his mates do their Bill Hall Trio act, which were very funny, of course. It was all slapstick and worked very well from that point of view, but Spike realised, you know, that there was limits to that and you just couldn't go on with that. And when he backed out on them, oh, they were not happy at all. In fact, they were furious.
Bill Earl said, I hope you never get a fucking job again. It was very venomous. By now, I was performing on the stage and had a wild act. normally you'd have an actor, he'd play the music, and go da 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 da. For me, there was nothing. There was stony silence. And then from the back of the stage, with a pair of zip-up slippers, I'd go do 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 do, and disappear behind the backstage. Do 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 do. Took a lot of nerve. This do 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 do. Oh do 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 do. Then I should go to the microphone and say, I must be a big disappointment to you. And I used to wonder why I didn't get much work.
Good heavens, a World War II radio. What better than to turn it on?
This is the BBC Light Programme, and candidly, I'm fed up with it.
Have a care there, Wallace.
Good heavens.
Otherwise, I'll be forced to speak to John Snack.
My dear fellow, Mr. everybody Gunshaw. Has to be forced to speak to John Snack.
I did that when I was alive.
The highly esteemed Gunshaw.
Secombe, take off those carbon plus fours.
Oh.
I shall now give the secret knock, and only he and I can know.
Who is it?
How many stories once do we break it down so I happen to help me and I live and breathe?
However did you get a name like that?
I have influence.
Open up, Mr. Kron. It's me, Eccles.
Oh, Eccles, it's me, Mr. Kron.
Oh, Mr. Kron, it's me, Eccles.
Oh, Mr. Eccles.
Yeah.
Well,
well. You idiot. Mr. Kron, sir, open this door at once.
I can't. It's locked and the key's locked.
Curse, the door's locked.
Try the window. That's open.
Right. Oh, curse, the window's locked as well.
The Grafton Arms was our mecca. What happened was I had an introduction to the publican, who was a pair of twin brothers, Jimmy and Peter Grafton. And Jimmy gave Spike lodging, because Spike was drifting at the time, I think, between lodgings. And he used to live in the attic.
Somehow, Jimmy Grafton, the landlord, asked me if I would write with him. So I've no idea why. Perhaps I'd told a few jokes or something, you know?
He's looked at the world and decided that it's peopled with idiots. And therefore he's created his own world of idiots in an extreme form. And if you think of the characters in The Goon Show, I've always told him that I think that Eccles is the true Milligan and the rest is just a cover.
Who's there?
It's me, Eccles. I got the window open. If you come out, you can crawl in through it.
We can't come out. The door's locked and we've lost the key.
So I wrote a script. It wasn't really very good, but it was unusual. And they said, all right, then write a show, put it on.
Echo?
Yeah?
It's me, Tin Buttons.
Oh, my friend!
Yes, I'm your friend. You remember me?
I don't remember you.
Yeah. Why do you not open the door?
How do you open a door?
You turn the knob on your side.
I haven't got a knob on my side. Peter was my particular close friend because he had this mad abstract mind. I met him in the bar with Benteen, and he was a rather swissy dresser. He had a very fine raincoat on. He was holding leather gloves in his hand, and he had a tilbury hat. And I thought, what a prat this bloke is. I didn't know him. We went to meet each other, and I got to like him because he was a very, very likeable man, if you really knew him. I dug him the most. I think I might sound a big head at times. I think I was his guru.
Deutschland, Deutschland, über alles.
I know that. Peter Sellers.
I know that fish.
Get out, Peter! It's gold spot.
It's gold spot.
You should have oh, you fooled you.
He had a tape recorder, and we started recording funny voices and things like that, you know. And we discovered by slowing it down, you could play it back very fast voices. We were very amused by these voices. The BBC, the jolly decent chaps, said, we'll call it the Junior Crazy Gang. I thought, well, what a pain in the arse they must be. So they called it the Crazy Gang, because that sounded more like we were crazy. So finally I said, no, I can't stand this. I want to call it the Goon Show. I don't want things like raise a laugh, take it from here, la, la, la. No, I just want a name, that's all. Goon Show, period.
There was a planners meeting and a lot of senior producers present. One of them got up and said, this go on show, what's it all about? Can't understand a word. That's supposed to be true. But, I mean, they persisted with it. And people used to say that they either they liked it or they hated it. There was nothing in between in the beginning.
Hey, Mr. Flatmuscle, my husband's just been shot. I've just come into the front room and found him lying on the carpet there.
Ah, oh, is he dead?
I think so.
Oh, hadn't you better make sure?
All right, just a minute. He's dead.
A certain type of audience that understood this humour we attracted. And, of course, the laughter sometimes was... It was like being given a course of vitamins. That's how good it felt, you know.
The hysteria that we generated between us was genuine, you know. Lots of giggles, smothered laughs in the background.
Good night, Henry.
Good night, Min.
There's somebody laughing outside the bedroom door.
It's that lodger. We must get rid of him, Min.
Did you take your male hormone pills?
Yes, ma'am.
How?
Yes. They give me the strength to go to sleep, ma'am.
The first series was very difficult in that Benteen has got this massive energy, and so had Spike, and so had Peter, and so had Harry, and so had I. I was the wrong guy. They needed a hard, cool cat to sort it out. But Benteen, very creative ideas, visual, technical, semi-intellectual in a way, documentary, rather than what became The Goon Show, which was beautiful, abstract, surreal, in another world, which was Spike.
I think Spike had this terrific driving ambition, and jolly good luck to him, because he certainly realised it. And I think he tended to write them down. And in the general kerfuffle, I think it was lost as to whose ideas were what.
No, there was tension, naturally. I mean, in the beginning, between Mike and Spike. Because Spike throws off ideas. I mean, Mike, they both do, throw off ideas like sparks from a Catherine wheel. And we all be sitting together, and somebody come up with an idea, and it would be expanded by somebody else. In the end, Spike and Mike would walk away thinking the idea was his, whereas really it was an amalgam of things that had happened at the sort of script conference.
I think that I was the fulcrum of the ideas. They were all thought of ideas, but they were too bloody lazy to write them down. Benteen was full of ideas, but never wrote them down.
There is a myth that the only source of ideas was Spike. And in the end, he became the focal point from the BBC's point of view, who hated us at first.
I think that Burnshaw would have balked at accepting a contract where he had to write 26 half-hour stories a year. It's overwhelming. It destroyed me completely. But that was the set number that they had to have on BBC scheduling, was 26 half-hours. 6 would have been enough. Might have lasted longer.
He doesn't always speak as fondly about the old days as the rest of us do, because they were tumultuous time for him. But it was a great strain on him. And, you know, he's to be congratulated for sticking with it. I mean, anybody else would have packed it in. But he had this... well, we rode on the thermal currents of his imagination, to be honest.
It's Moriarty, where are you?
Here, in the piano.
What the devil are you doing in there?
I'm hiding.
Don't be silly. Haydn's been dead for years.
Silence! I don't wish to know that.
Neither do I.
I say, look here. Now help me out. I'm disguised as one of the piano strings.
Which string are you?
I think I'm a G string.
So that's why I can't see you.
Now then, I'm not sure which string I am, so you better play a scale.
Do.
No.
Re.
No.
Me.
Me, that's me. Help me out. Thank you.
I realize why Van Gogh was a manic depressive, and yet he had to go on painting. It's like me, I couldn't stop. I was having these depressions. I couldn't stop. Even when I was in the mental home, I would take pencil and paper with me and write down ideas for the show.
I've always felt that writing is basically an obsessional sport. I don't think that anything really happens when you're writing until it becomes obsessional. You can sit around working 9 to 5 and having meetings with other people and nothing happens in the writing meanwhile, you know? Then one day you click into obsessional behavior and it all starts going on the paper. That's my experience. And I think those parts of Spike's personality that are obsessional, which may be connected with the depression, you know, that's what enabled him to do that over the years. But I think you pay such a price in terms of loneliness.
I realized that this was absolutely a new breakthrough in radio history, because before all you'd had was, hello, who's that? Come in. And that was all the sound effects. But Spike took it a step further, and he brought in abstract sound effects, like, you've got to go to China immediately.
I bet that's done him a power of good.
There had never been anything in British broadcasting like what was going on inside Spike's brain. This was so new. Listen to this.
Is it, Eccles?
Just a minute. I got it written down here on a piece of paper. A nice man wrote the time down for me this morning.
Oh. Then why do you carry it around with you, Eccles?
Well, if anybody asks me the time... I can show it to them.
Wait a minute, Eccles, my good man.
What is it, fellow?
It's written on this bit of paper. What is 8 o'clock, is written.
I know that, my good fellow. That's right. When I asked a fellow to write it down, it was 8 o'clock.
Well, then, supposing when somebody asks you the time, it isn't 8 o'clock.
Well, then I don't show it to them.
Great, great, lovely logic. Beautiful.
Oh. Well, how do you know when it's 8 o'clock?
I got it written down on a piece of paper.
She was exactly what I wanted. She was dark. She was Italian. She had boobs. And she had all the equipment necessary to take her to the altar steps. I wanted to look after them so badly. I wanted them to have everything I'd never had. It sounds like a cliche. Wait a minute, it is, isn't it? And the pressure of that life and was just laid me low. My mother and father never let me go anywhere near any kind of responsibility. The first time that happened was when I got married to June, and I couldn't handle it. I thought, what, how am I going to serve having babies and all that, and what am I going to do? And I started to break down again. I started to go to pieces. And I'm not surprised she left me. I'm not surprised. She was a very good mother and a very, very nice woman. God, how do we get rid of our mistakes, Alan? How do you wipe them out? You just can't, can you? They stay with you. I started to become strange. I thought she was spending a lot of money because she had about 25 pairs of shoes. It's like a Imelda Marcos, an earlier Imelda Marcos. And she had lots and lots of clothes. And I thought she wasn't being economical. I can't imagine what I was doing wrong. I was doing something which was breaking the marriage up. I don't know what it was.
Lots of rows, I remember that. And, you know, it's the same syndrome as, I suppose, a lot of other households, that you got put in your room and everybody thinks you can't hear what's going on. But we were all quite aware that things weren't going too well.
He was in such a neurotic state that you didn't know how to take him. He was up and down and up, you know. Yeah, it was like treading on eggs, being around him.
I got this telegram saying that June had left the home and taken the children with her. And I think it was a token suicide. I had some sleeping tablets and I took quite a large number. I think it was a cry for help somehow. Yeah.
Basically, he's a romantic, and he was very deeply in love with his first wife. And when that began to break up and he had his illness, he became more and more withdrawn and began basically to hate women. A feeling I'm sure he has to this very day. I don't think he really likes women.
Yes, I'm very ashamed of my treatment of June. And I'm sorry that I lost them their mother. That was terrible. Of course, she was then the guilty party, wasn't she? Having committed adultery. They didn't say anything about me being fucking mad, insane, unstable, no, suicidal. That was okay. You can have three kids to look after when you're like that. That's how the law was, yeah. That's when I think I must do something to prove I love them. So I wrote this book of poems called Silly Verse for Kids.
My sister Laura is bigger than me and lifts me up quite easily. I can't lift her. I've tried and tried. She must have something heavy inside.
We're with our father, and I'm really pleased that we're brought up with my father, because we've had a sort of... Now I'm older, I can see what special upbringing we had, although it was very tough sometimes. But it's very sad also on the other half that we never saw our mother for some... I mean, that's still an unanswered question. Not even I know the answer of why we never saw her through all those years.
Today I saw a little worm wriggling on his belly. Perhaps he'd like to come inside and see what's on the telly.
He was reliving his innocence of childhood because he couldn't bear the world. And he's told us quite categorically that he would have killed himself if it wasn't for us.
There are holes in the sky where the rain gets in, but they're ever so small. That's why rain is thin.
It's very easy to think that I remember things that I don't, because there's so many old family films that we see all the time. But I think my earliest recollections are of a father who used to come home very late at night, and I used to literally get up and sit and wait on the stairs in the middle of the night. And he used to take me up to his bedroom, and he used to just open the windows, and we used to look at the stars together. And that was really nice, and then he'd put me to bed.
I was besotted with them. But that's what we were saying earlier, what's a human being's in love with themselves. And I wrote very little pieces of paper in minuscule writing to Laura and Sean, and we came and saw you last night, and we flew over your bed, and what a nice bedclothes you have, a nice warm bed, signed the Pixies and Fairies. I had to make a little stamp for it, put it in somewhere in the garden, and they had to go and look for it. And they'd find it, they would write back.
We had quite a big garden, and I used to leave letters in the garden, and poor old Deb must have had to sort of sort his way through trees and undergrowth looking for these letters we'd written for the fairies. And he used to leave us little tiny letters back. And that went on for a long time. I remember having a fight with the boy down in the stream who said, you know, you're a narn if you believe that. And I said, it's true, because I've got proof. My imagination was very fertile up to about 12.
By the teenage years, it actually felt like a betrayal. I felt betrayed because I suddenly felt the world was there with all its hardships. It became apparent that things had to be engaged in life, and I had no equipment, I felt, virtually whatsoever, because I'd almost lived out sort of this fantasy childhood. Although it had some very real points in it, it was a major shock.
There was a baboon who one afternoon said, I think I will fly to the sun. So with two great arms strapped to his arms, he started his take-off run. Mile after mile, he gathered the sun, but never once left the ground. You're running too slow, said a passing crow. Try reaching the speed of sound. Reaching the speed of sound.
He was devastated. The whole of his family had gone, you know. And he said to me later, he said, I thought I'd never see you all again. He was shattered. He didn't show it, but he obviously was.
My father was a fascist. He saw his first colored bus conductor going to Fleet Street. He got off the bus, came back home, and said to my mother, pack up. We're going to go with the white man's country.
Let's get some light on here. This is where they used to live very, very happily. And very, very, very happily indeed. They can also get the blind to go up. And I can.
This is my mother, by the way. She never was just my mother, by the way. She's here all the time. This is my dad. Dad, I think you two ought to meet each other.
The father was Irish. That says it all. He woke me up at 3 one morning. I said, "Wake up, son." I said, "What is it, Dad?" He said, "I've never shot a tiger." I said, "Why are you telling me?" He said, "I've got to tell somebody."
I hope you're enjoying this. I'm enjoying it, you know. It's come over here for this very reason, just to get away. And I used to come up this hill nearly every day at one time. I'm getting older, of course.
We are at Daly's Point on the Brisbane waters, and we're standing where at one time a people called the Darug tribe used to live. This huge platform here, when I discovered it 50 years ago, was one mass of Aborigine carvings. The people have gone, alas, erosion has eroded away all the wonderful carvings that I used to see. That's the cave there. That's where the Darug tribe used to live. Inside this cave, 50 years ago, there was a rock shelf here, and it was covered in salt-encrusted sand. And I just happened to rest my hand there, and it went in, and I scraped the salt sand away, and there was a pecked carving of a dingo. But then, the most extraordinary thing, I washed the sand away and came across men in a rowing boat. Now, Captain Phillips came up this way in 1798, and what I was seeing was the Aborigines' first pictograph of white men coming up the rip in Brisbane waters. That used to be here and was protected, but as you can see, the vandals are rampant. We've written their names here, these bastards. It's gone forever. The tribe have gone forever. The carving's nearly gone, and the Yahoos have ripped this cave open and destroyed the rock with those very pecked carvings on. Not much to be said for the human race. What's so important about it? Tell me, what is important about human beings? What?
Reuben Croucher walked with crane-like dignity across the black, cracking lino to the window. His long, thin nose pointed the way. A million rivers of tiny ruptured veins suffused his cadaverous face. Two watery eyes, like fresh cracked eggs in lard, looked out from a skull-like head.
I had a great surge of being Celtic, and I would like to be known as an Irish writer. Of course, I already was. Nobody knew I was Irish. But I had some kind of patriotic feeling towards my country. And I started to write in my father's gun room in Woy Woy. I started it there. In this house, Spike Milligan wrote the following books: Silly Verse for Kids, 1959, Pakoon, 1959. Adolf Hitler, my partner's downfall, 1969.
What's it like being Mrs. Spike Milligan?
Interesting. I don't really, I wouldn't know how to answer that question.
She was a lady through and through. I think she came from a very Victorian background where the wife and the husband were together every night with the family, having meat and two veg and that kind of thing. But Dad was another, a whole other thing. A different energy altogether. He was a creative mind. He liked to go out and do what he wanted and was up all night writing in his office. So she couldn't recreate that in our family, and I think it troubled her quite a lot. But she went with it, obviously, because she loved him and tried to make it work as best she could. But it was quite tough, I think.
Well, he seems to feel that the world's responsibilities are his. Takes them on his own shoulders and makes them his own responsibilities.
There's a lot of arguments and tension. And she was a lovely woman, and Dad was a manic depressive, and I just feel like they're a red rag to each other.
I was only 11, Sile was about 18 or 19, so we heard a doctor had come in and told her that she was dying and that it did finish her, really. Her spirit was crushed at that point and she couldn't go on anymore.
Fortunately, I told Jane the night before Paddy died. I sat with the Scottish Nana and I said, Jane, Mummy's dying. And she said, no. She'll be better by Christmas, Daddy. I said, no. I said, I'm sorry, she's dying. She said, but I'm only 11. Oh. Tell me something worse than that. I don't know of it.
Good Lord, I'm 104.
Yeah.
Look up, please. Lovely.
Round here, please.
Round here, please.
And round
here,
please.
Hey, AIDS. I've got AIDS. Don't come near me. I've got AIDS.
BBC Radio, Matt Leach.
We can still be friends.
I thought you might...
Like poor Edward G. Robinson. He was on his deathbed when they gave him his award. At showbiz.
So our winner of the main Oldie Award of the year is Mr. Spike Milligan.
Thank you. I'll have it valued in the morning. I was going to say, ladies and gentlemen, and the dying. And this dear Prince of Wales was telling me these occasions, he has to go to certain places. One he had to go to was a sperm bank, and he had to wear a white jacket, and leather gloves, and a hat. So he was watching all this display, and then he suddenly said, I heard myself saying, how do they get it? And his equerry sprang to it and said, it's done manually, my lord.
I did a show, an ad-lib show, at the end of 1955, and the next morning I had a phone call from somebody I didn't know who said either that was the worst television show I've ever seen, or you have some ideas that might be interesting. Can we have lunch? I said, well, I'll choose the latter if I might. And it was Peter Sellers. And I had only heard the Goon shows. I'd never met any of them. And we had lunch and we talked, and he said, we must go see Spike because I think we can do something together. So we went round to see Spike, who was lying on the floor with his head in a coil of huge maritime hawser rope. And without looking up, Spike said, comedy never works on television. There's no point in even trying. Don't try to convince me. It won't work at all. I can write an idea which I have people dropping through a hole in the ice, and they can come up in the middle of Hyde Park, and you can't do that on any budgets. So there's no point in even restricting myself to this work. Go away. So we went away and decided to do the first of the series without him, and we hired a lot of young writers like Johnny Spate and John Junkin and any number of them, I think about 12, with Eric Sykes as the script supervisor.
You rang, sir?
Yes, would you drive me home?
Of course, sir.
And we put the first show on, and it had good reviews, and Peter was in it, and Graham Stark, and Valentine Dow. And at 8:30 the next morning, Spike was on the phone saying, I'm coming in with a running order for show two. So suddenly we were together, and we did all three series from then on.
Feeling low down, and you can't find romance, leap into a dustbin and dance. Oh, and your friend forsake you, and you can't find romance, jump into a dustbin and dance. Throw out all that rubbish, show them you don't care. When they come to empty it won't be there. No trousers with ragged underpants, just leap into that dustbin and die!
I think Spike found difficulties with his television series in that the moment you start showing things in the square box that are cerebrally funny on radio, they're very funny. The moment you actually see it being done by somebody else as opposed to by your imagination, it is not as funny as it would be listening to radio. And Spike had the disadvantage too, that his brain is so active that he could never leave his own scripts alone, so that he would write one of his cue shows and all through rehearsal keep adding to it and adding to it until almost he lost sight of what the original intention was.
Whenever like people like Spike Milligan do something, it's always got their fingerprint on it. Like, you know immediately it's them. And when he did the Q series, he opened up another door into visual comedy that was an offshoot of the Goon shows. But he did some marvellous things which were, I mean, you cannot say, you can only know by instinct like Spike did.
The great problem with sketch writing is, as anybody who writes it knows and most people who watch it know, is that you can rarely find a line to end that's as good as some of the lines that have gone before.
That's enough of the sketch, I'd say. So let's do something else. Yes, yes. What'll we do? What'll we do? They kept moving. What'll we do?
What are we going to do now? 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 Sit cups, he said. What are we going to do now?
This is a brain that's just a little ahead of everybody else. But when you watch it on the screen, it's funny. But nobody knows why it's funny. Like when there's a vicar and he shakes his head and there's all this, which is like dandruff flying around. It's only talcum powder. You think of that. And it's a new dimension.
At his best improvising, he would be wonderful. But then if he'd just say something crass the next minute and you'd say to him, Spike, we can't use that, he says, oh. He said, all right, I'll say nothing. So it was either the tap was on and you got the lot, or it was, tell me what to do and I will do it. Mine's greater than mine, obviously no better. So you had to take your pick. I usually tried to keep the tap flowing and get everything and hope that we could edit out what needed to be done. So with Spike, it was a rich life, I say that.
49.
again to Tracy.
There was no logic with Spike. That's the beauty. You had to break every rule working with Spike. You know, if it was rehearsed on Tuesday and Thursday in the rehearsal room, people didn't laugh, he didn't think it was funny, and on the night he'd change it a third time. Sometimes it was better, often it wasn't better. But, I mean, that was Spike.
Quiet, please.
We spend years writing our shows to make it look like it's just we've walked in and done it, but he did it so much better than us, I think.
It's an attitude as well, isn't it? It's going where you always leave, you know, we always leave room for a hesitation, which isn't a hesitation. And he, I suspect, you don't know, but he was very good at pretending to crack up at his own jokes.
Yeah.
And I'm sure it was a pretense, but he did it very well. I mean, it's acting, really, isn't it?
Yeah. He was a brilliant actor.
And it comes from a realisation that with someone like Spike Milligan, I'm sure with it, like, it's him who's funny, not necessarily what he's saying, you know, like, if he doesn't perform, if he's not Spike Milligan in front of the camera, then it's not going to work.
Here is the Reverend Franklin with a few calming words.
Librium valium mundum.
I can still remember the quality of those shows, and I remember how much they rattled me and Terry Jones, because I rang Terry one evening and said, did you by any chance watch, I think it was Q3, and he said, yes, are you thinking what I'm thinking? And I said, yes, he's doing Python before we got there.
Without Q, there would have been no Python. They'd been trying, they'd tried at last the 1947 show, all this, but they didn't know that you could actually have a show with no beginnings and no ends, with interruptions.
I think it was more risky than the Pythons. It was like, you did have to sort of like turn around to parents and say, am I allowed to laugh at that? With the Pythons, you didn't. Not so much, anyway.
Spike used to say, and he was quite right, that it is amazing that people are paying us this money to make each other laugh, which is what we did. We made each other laugh a lot. And he used to say, this is the best part of it. This is the part, because this is the part where no other influence has been brought to bear. It's just two guys who put some words on the paper and they've made each other laugh.
You've seen this cover.
Yes.
And Rod brought it yesterday, and
is it for a coffin or is it for a book?
This is for a book. Listen, this is serious, because I really don't like this and I'm not accepting it, so... I just don't like the whole thing, right?
That's good. Throw it away.
Well, the book's coming out.
Hold on and say, look, I don't like the whole thing, and hang up. That's what I like, instant decisions. Finish it, get it over with, you know.
So if...
Try and look busy, Norma.
No, listen, Spike, if we don't get these, because I know that you like these, can I substitute that for my favourite picture?
Yes.
Yes, because I really like that.
I've no idea why.
It's lovely.
There's something wrong with me to leave these sort of photographs hanging around.
So, OK, so I'll try and work, you see, here.
Keep it still. Let him focus in. We're getting paid for this, don't forget.
Spike is the most disciplined person you will ever wish to meet. When he wants to do something and he sets his mind to do it, that's it. If it's not that important to him, you have to nurture to get on with it. I mean, can we take this time to talk things about you? What are you doing next week?
Yeah, I'm sorry, I'm being very diverse.
No, you're not.
I was reading this book, The Loony. And yes, what?
Monday, Spike, you're going to HMV to do a big signing session for the Bible, the talking version of the Bible, right?
Yes, I think the Pope must have put a fatwa out on me for that. There's a nation of Catholics waiting to set me on fire.
I think you should say yes. Right?
Yes.
He once said something to me and it chilled me. He said, if I lost the ability to write, then the prospect of suicide would look very great to me. That chilled me. So I think everything else from his writing is very secondary to him.
That's Prince Charles trying to set fire to me. That's me pretending I'm a royalist. She didn't know that the IRA had given me half a ton of Semtex, which was strapped to my back. She was very lucky to get away that night. God save our gracious queen. I find that very unfair. What about Philip? He's there as well, isn't he? Shouldn't be God save our gracious queen and Prince Philip. And wait, there's the queen, Mum. They're having a... God save our gracious queen and Prince Philip and the Queen Mother. What about Charles? He's had enough stick, hasn't he? He wants some praise. God save our gracious Queen and Prince Philip and the Queen Mother and the Prince of Wales.